Hello. We've probably all thought about finding balance in our lives, whether we've considered our work-life balance or how to balance our diets or even how to balance our checkbooks. But when it comes to literal balance, the kind of balance that we need to stand up and not fall over, we generally only think about it when we have to. During our first year of life, we probably thought about balance a lot, and undoubtedly most of us fell over hundreds of times while we figured out how to do it. By 6 months of age, we likely had developed enough core strength to sit up without toppling over too often. By 9 months, we were maybe crawling on all fours and pulling up for support. And by the time we hit our first birthday, we were likely standing on 2 feet, taking our first steps, and learning how to shift our weight from 1 foot to the other in sequence to avoid falling on our bums. Before long, we were unstoppable, off to the races with adults chasing close behind. And we probably haven't looked back too much since. I have thought about balance quite a lot because I am a dancer. Not long after I learned how to walk, I began twirling and leaping, and my parents had no choice but to put me into dance class. While studying classical ballet, I learned how to balance on one leg while lifting the other leg high up in the air. Eventually, I learned how to do that while teetering on the very tip of a wooden pair of pointe shoes. Now, I teach dance to university students, and at the beginning of every year, I ask them to set 5 goals for growth. Nearly every single student lists as one of their goals that they would like to improve their balance. In talking with them, I have realized that what most of these students are saying is, I would like to get better at standing on one leg, motionlessly, held static in space, as though I was a floating statue, freed from the physical laws that govern objects under gravity. At least when I was a dancer, that was often my own personal goal, to suspend myself motionlessly on 1 foot while floating, and to make it look utterly effortless. But is stillness really the best measure of balance, or even a desirable one? In a state of perfect stillness, how ready are you to respond to an obstacle in your path? Or is a dynamic, flexible, adaptive state more conducive to letting us respond to the whims of the winds? Imagine all the ways you had to adapt to the world already today. You likely used vision to help you see the path in front of you. You may have held on to a handrail as you descended a flight of stairs, using touch to help guide you. You might have heard a passerby behind you and moved over to let them pass. You might have even tripped on a crack in the sidewalk, quickly sensed that change in position, and responded to right yourself. This would be thanks to your vestibular system. Your vestibular system is located deep within your inner ears and composed of millions of tiny sensors that detect changes in speed and direction. If you trip and start to fall, these tiny cells can detect that quick acceleration and give you information to help you right yourself. All of your sensory systems, or these sensory systems, visual, auditory, vestibular, and touch, work together to provide you information about your surroundings and how your body fits into them. If one system fails to provide you information, then you compensate by relying more heavily on other systems. If you've ever had to get up in the night and go to the bathroom in the dark, you know this to be true. Without your sense of vision, you have to rely more on other senses, on things like touching the walls, sensing the floor beneath you, and listening to the rustling of your own movement to find your way in the dark. I am not only interested in balance as a dancer, I'm also a movement scientist, compelled to understand what was going on in the brain to enable my own embodied experience. I went back to school to study neuroscience. Now I work in a movement analysis laboratory where I quantify movement and balance through technology like wearable sensors, force plates, pressurized mats, and 3D motion capture. Part of what we do in our lab is to test balance under different conditions. For instance, I can see how well your sensory systems are providing you information by taking one of your senses away. Like that example I gave of trying to navigate to the bathroom in the dark, I can ask people to do balance tasks with their eyes closed to see how well their other systems step up to fill in the missing information. We can also alter the surface of the floor and have people stand on an inclined plane or on soft foam to see how quickly their systems respond and adapt when the floor beneath them is less stable. Remember those students I talked about who were trying to balance motionlessly on one foot? We assess that too. This is something we call static balance. Static balance is a measure of how well you can hold perfectly still. Of course, we're never perfectly still. Even when we think we're standing perfectly still, we are constantly making millions of tiny micro adjustments to maintain our balance. Now, static balance is a very useful measure, but it does not reveal the full picture. So we also assess dynamic balance. Dynamic balance is a measure of how well you can stay upright during movement tasks, while walking or getting up out of a chair, things that we do in our everyday lives. Static and dynamic balance have to work together continuously because balance is complex and our needs shift depending on every situation. To drive home this point, imagine a simple task, going to the grocery store. You walk into the store dynamically, you grab a cart, you start pushing it down the aisle, and then, oh, you see some salsa, and it might be taco night. So you stop, you peruse the options, you check the price points, you grab a jar, make your selection, put it into your cart, and continue on your merry way. In this rather everyday example, you can see how effortlessly and seamlessly and automatically you shift easily between static and dynamic tasks. The good news is that because we do this every day, all day long, you all are experts at it. You do this really well already. Every time you take a step, you shift your torso slightly beforehand so that you are ready and positioned to transfer weight from one foot to the next. We do this through anticipatory adjustments, where we stay alert to our surroundings and anticipate what comes next, and through reactive adjustments, where we respond to perturbations in our path and quickly reorganize to stay in motion. Your motor system is finely tuned to help you continuously respond to an obstacle and reorganize so that you can anticipate your next move. What better analogy for life? Anticipate and respond and try to stay upright. All of the work I do relates to one central question. How can we help people stay standing? Or rather, stay in equilibrium as we move throughout the world? Because what happens when you go out of equilibrium? You fall. In our world, we define a fall as making unexpected contact with the floor. In other words, as suddenly and unintentionally arriving at stillness. Remember those toddlers who are learning how to walk? Since toddlerhood, we've probably barely thought about balance at all. We take it for granted that we'll be able to balance through our days and not fall over. But the truth is, as we age, our ability to balance declines. All of our sensory systems start to provide less information. So we might not see the crack in the sidewalk. We might not hear that passerby brush by us. We might get dizzy because our vestibular system gives us faulty information. Just one failure of one sensory system in one moment could result in making sudden, unexpected contact with the floor. By the age of 70, 30% of us will have experienced a fall. Of those, half will fall again within the next year. Falls affect a lot of people. They are the leading cause of injury among older adults, and they also come at an extreme cost. In our lab, I often work with people with balance impairment due to aging or to neurologic decline. For them, making sudden contact with the floor is dangerous business. It can lead to hip fractures, which are costly and especially common in women who are more susceptible to bone density loss. It can also lead to head injuries or other orthopedic problems that require rehabilitation. Falling also decreases quality of life, as it can be embarrassing. It can negatively impact confidence. Whether your first fall occurs in your home or out in the world, it can lead people to go out less, become more homebound, and more isolated from their social circles. Thus, preventing that very first fall is the best way to keep people out and about moving in the world. The primary aim of my work is to find ways that I can use dance and exercise to help people modulate their movement patterns. Drawing upon my dance experience, I develop interventions that might help people stay active for longer. I use dance to help strengthen muscles, increase flexibility, and improve coordination. I also teach people how to fall. By practicing gracefully getting down to the floor and back up with ease, maybe we can be less likely to injure ourselves if we do fall. We often consider the floor a dangerous, scary place, but it's not fearful. It's a place of stability. It is always there. The floor is your friend, we say in dance. Maybe by getting friendly with it, we can remember to trust it in those moments when we need it the most. Some of our interventions use dance improvisation as a vehicle for self-expression, particularly for bodies that are where people feel less at home in their own bodies. For people with neurological disorders like Parkinson's disease, this can take on special significance as their bodies no longer receive motor commands as they once did. In a body that's becoming more rigid and less labile, finding new pathways for movement and new strategies might reinvigorate a body with fewer resources available. We have also used more traditional dance forms. In my latest study, I returned to my roots, to ballet. I asked the question, could a dance form that emphasizes verticality and lightness help improve postural stability for older women? Over the past 2 years, we recruited older women from our community, and we randomized them to either a virtual ballet class or a virtual wellness class. The ballet class was a modified ballet class where they could use chairs as bars, and they did static and dynamic postures. For the wellness class, they were still learning a lot about health, but it was inactive. And what we saw was that both interventions allowed people a chance to connect with other women and improve their quality of life. It seems like connecting during time of isolation particularly really helped people find a sense of equilibrium in their lives. But for the ballet group, we saw even more improvements in balance. We saw that they improved static balance. They were able to hold static postures for longer and sway less while doing so. We also saw that they were better able to anticipate movement during dynamic moves. They were able to get up faster out of chairs and respond quicker during complex and challenging tasks. And the best part, people in the ballet group significantly reduced their number of falls. Albert Einstein once said, "Life is like riding a bicycle. To keep your balance, you must keep moving." Trying to suspend yourself motionlessly in midair will never lead to perfect balance. You have to continually adapt and respond to your own internal signals as well as to your environment to stay moving and to find equilibrium. Everyone in this room will likely one day experience a fall. You will accidentally, inadvertently make contact with the ground. My hope for you is that when you do, you are able to adapt and respond, find a friend in the floor, and are able to get back up and keep moving. Thank you.